Right back here in the Proactive Vancouver studio, and joining me now is Mark Emalfarb, the president and CEO of Dyadic International. And Mark, it's always great to see you. How are you doing?
Well, we're locked down, Steve, like the rest of the world. So, yeah. But we're very busy, and I'm busier than ever.
Yeah, it really is a crazy time for sure. And that's why I wanted to start off with talking about COVID-19 and the initiatives that you're working with a number of companies about that. So tell me where you're at with COVID.
Well, COVID is just one of the opportunities we're working on. Our regular business is ongoing. It's been pretty well uninterrupted in terms of the work, the inflow of new products, new opportunities. But on the coronavirus, when it came up, we thought that our technology could be applied to help mass produce a vaccine or an antibody quicker, faster, and cheaper with better potential potency. And so we're applying that in programs today with the Israeli Institute of Biological Research, where we've been carrying on sort of a epidemic platform approach for the last 2 years, where we help them already make an enzyme to help defend against sarin gas attacks or VX gas. And so they have 50 scientists working on coronavirus, finding genes for vaccines and antibodies. And they came to us and decided that they're going to apply C1 as one of the platforms to see if, in fact, we can't be the one that produces more of it for less in a better way. And that's one of the examples of what we're working on. Another example is we were working for the last 5 years almost with the zoonotic anticipation and preparedness initiative out of the EU. And as it coincidentally, they were working not only on the Zappi antigen that we produced at 35 times higher levels than the second place cell line baculovirus, and we can get into that as well, but three of the top 20 coronavirus scientists, experts in the world, are in that program. And together with them, we put together a proposal where they found a gene or different genes for different antigen or vaccine candidates, and we're working together on expressing those in C1 based on the success they've had. In fact, there was an article on the IMI website just in the last few days that talked about how C1 is this really new developing expression technology that can really change the game in terms of yield, productivity, and cost. So that's another one example. And then we have other things going on with UFOVAX and Scripps. That's the Scripps research out of La Jolla. Actually, Scripps is also here in Florida, but this particular scientist in La Jolla that is working again with SARS and MERS, and he's an expert on this disease itself, and he's come up with a nanoparticle. And again, it really comes down to, it's great to have these vaccine candidates, but if you can't make them in large enough quantities to give enough to everybody on the planet at an affordable price, we can end up with the same problem we have now with ventilators, masks, and diagnostic kits. And it'll really be a shame if the world ends up a year from now, or 18 months from now, or 2 years from now, and they come out with a vaccine and nobody has access to it. I think it'll cause a revolution, actually. Can you imagine not having access to a vaccine and everyone else getting it?
Yeah, especially after what we've gone through in the last little while.
Yeah, so I think really it's a critical thing that people need to think about. It's not just about diagnostic kits and masks and ventilators today. It's about thinking in the future what we're going to need, and we better be prepared. And we've been working with the Zappi group and Israelis for the several years, getting prepared for zoonotic diseases, pandemics, epidemics. So we were actually in place with the right partners to jump into this game, with real people that have real knowledge about the disease, animal models that can bring them towards clinical studies. And then there's a variety of other people we're in talks with, governmental agencies, institutions, as well as companies to apply the technology to really try to bring affordable vaccines and antibodies to the public on a global basis.
Mark, I want to talk to you about a couple other things, because you had a news release out today talking about a deal you signed with WuXi Biologics. Tell me a little bit about them and who they are and what this is going to do for Dyadic.
Well, actually, we issued that yesterday, by the way. It was WuXi is a contract development and manufacturing organization. They're one of the top 10 leading CDMOs in the world. They work with dozens of big pharmaceutical companies and biotech companies in producing the proteins for them on a contract basis. These are some of the most innovative scientists, and they're forward thinking, and they're building this new microbial fermentation facility, and they're looking for new, better, faster ways to make these biologics for their customers and for their associated collaborators. And they look at they look at C1 as a potential workhorse that could do just that, make massive amounts of lower cost vaccines and antibodies at a fraction of the price. They can treat people more affordably on a global basis. And so CDMOs are one of the targets we have, and we're talking to the other CDMOs all over the world as well, and in, of course, in the United States. But there's really an unlimited amount of potential collaborators for a platform technology like C1.
Mark, let's also talk about, you have some news about your animal health area, and specifically you're working with another company. Now, that means that, if I'm correct, you basically are working out with three of the top four companies now as far as animal health is concerned. It's pretty impressive.
Well, I think the problem and the solution are obvious. Animal health needs quicker, faster ways and really lower cost ways of bringing these to animals, right? They can't afford to pay expensive prices for protein drugs or vaccines, or they won't get put into animals because you can't, you know, the reimbursement's not the same, right? So the difference here is, because of the Zappi group, again, back to that same zoonotic disease, we were working on a Schmallenberg virus project where I mentioned we made it at 17 times what Zappi asked us to, and 35 times the nearest competitor. And so what you have, the data, when you show that kind of data, and now we have animal data that just came out as well. We talked about it last January, that in December, we had preliminary data from Zappi showing the effectiveness, not only the high productivity and low cost. And now we have more supportive data that demonstrates both in the cattle and the mice, we fully protected them. So when you have data like that, it's easy to make business decisions if you're on the other side of the coin, looking at if you can use C1 to make lower cost vaccines and antibodies, and you're getting equal, if not better, protection for the animal, I'd say that's an easy sell. And so we'll see what happens now in these three, and we're working on others. So we're just getting rolling on the animal health side.
Mark, also, can you give me an update on the Serum Institute program? Where's that at?
Well, Serum, as you know, or may not know, but we've talked about in the past, is the largest producer of vaccines globally by volume. So they work with the Gates Foundation, they work with IAVI, they work with WHO, et cetera, on a variety of different vaccines. It's not an institute, it's actually a company, so the name's a misnomer. And so they've signed an agreement with us that provides them with access to C1 for 8 antibodies and 4 vaccines. And they've provided us now with half of those products, you know, the gene targets, and we're in the middle of now re-expressing those genes in our new glycoengineered strains. Because if you remember, we just announced recently, we've been successful in glycoengineering the C1 strains to impart human-like glycan structures, which means we can produce antibodies now without a negative immune response.
And Mark, last thing I want to talk to you about is, I wanted to get a bit of an update on the Sanofi Aventis and whether or not that's going to move forward.
Well, Sanofi Aventis, again, we've been working with for over a year. The data is done from our part. They've now finished the analytics, or very close to that. And we've been working together with their scientists to put together presentations that they can give to their upper management and show the data. And we think the data is quite compelling. And I think, as we've mentioned in our press release yesterday, we've matter exceeded the protein production levels that they asked us to in more than half of those proteins. So kind of like you've seen the Zappi, we've been able to get really high levels of certain proteins at very, very low cost. And so now they're going to evaluate that data, and they're going to look at where it fits in for Sanofi. The data is very good, it's very compelling, but it's got to fit where they need it. And hopefully they'll come out with, they need it for A, B, and C, or they want to expand the research program, make it broader, wider, deeper, or potentially take a license from us for one protein, a class of proteins, or who knows what.
Well, it's, even though you're at your home and you're you know, doing everything you could for COVID, you're still extremely very busy, it sounds like, at the company.
Yeah, we're extremely overworked, overwhelmed. But the good thing is, we're really trying to help the world bring the cost of healthcare down. I think what you got to realize is, we can kill 3 birds with 1 stone working on COVID-19, and that is solve the outbreak by potentially bringing new, better vaccines or antibodies at lower cost to people. 2, getting ready for the next pandemic so that we actually are in better shape when the next one comes and ahead of the curve, which we've been working with the Zappi group and the Israeli Institute of Biological Research already for several years. And 3, ultimately, drive the cost of biologic vaccines and drugs to mainstream vaccines and drugs, prescription drugs down, so that people can afford to get these things. So it's really an amazing thing that's going on. And it's kind of like if you think about when you went to the moon and you had a big IBM computer and what that led to from a technology and how that spread, the money that the government's spending on this outbreak potentially can bring great value in the pharmaceutical industry, and in particular with C1 on driving the cost down and being better prepared for the future.
Mark, thanks very much for the update. Sure, appreciate it.
Great. Thanks a lot. Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you as well. Mark Emalfarb, the president and CEO of Dyadic International.